fighting a bunch of dudes we don't trust, aligned with some fellas who are total idiots who want Iraq to fall apart. Kurds, nerds, and a group named after the Egyptian mother goddess who has given birth to a bubbling civil war in Iraq. Who is ISIS? What happened to Iraq? And how do we stifle John McCain's growing war lust? It's always there. He's pretty randy for an older fella. Well, let's put it to our party panel. We've got Michael Moynihan, a decorated columnist and foreign policy expert at the Daily Beast. And Gavin McInnes. He is a Talkie Mag contributor and a thoughtful human. Believe it or not, despite the facial hair, they've got some good stuff in store for you. So let's start with Iraq. What are the next steps?
The hell if I know. I mean, can we stop saying what are the next steps? Not to ask, say it's a bad question. We always think that there's some these steps that if we only take, it's going to affect the
outcome. So what do you do? I mean, okay, then I guess the question is, what do you do? Do you just let it devolve? Does America sit back?
I mean,
do you send
evacuate,
in the drones?
You
send
evacuate in the embassy. You evacuate the embassy. You declare defeat because that's what
with
we're
doing. With the
help
doing. Of
Marines
and
managing, soldiers? We're managing the defeat. Obama announced today that he's sending 275 troops in basically to secure the embassy as well as it could be secured, or maybe to make sure that we don't have that photo op from the U.S. Embassy in Saigon in 1975. Let's get the helicopter out of the shot this time around. He has no idea. We are managing a slow motion retreat here. That's what he's done as president in Iraq. And now all the people who started out the war to begin with are saying, well, he lost the war instead of this guy losing the war. The whole war has been lost. If you want some hate porn, go look at the testimony of Bill Kristol, Weekly Standard editor. And
Bill Kristol? You mean the guy with a million teeth?
And the forever interventionist. He gave a talk in front of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee before the Iraq War in February 2002. It said, I think the important thing to not lose sight of here is that, you know, there's really some opportunity for positive things here. It would, a good Iraq war would transform the Middle East. A friendly, free, and oil-producing Iraq would leave Iran isolated. I think Syria would be cowed. And, of
Probably.
Course, the Palestinians
no, he's,
would
I mean, he essentially is a psychic.
Yeah, not quite.
He's the Miss Cleo.
I can tell you what we ought to do at this point going forward. We should stop listening to the people who got us into this mess to begin with. 6 days, 6 weeks, 6 months, apparently 60 years would have been the right amount of time to stay and try to secure Iraq, make everything work properly. Tony Blair just a few days ago, we have to liberate ourselves from this notion that we have caused this. We haven't. Who is we? No, it's you. It's you and the rest of the folks who got us into this conflict to begin with and who created a total disaster. It is impossible for us to separate ourselves from the fact that we went into it, we invaded, we occupied. 129,000 civilians have died in Iraq at this point. It is incredible. It is an astronomical figure.
Yeah.
Not to mention the U.S. service people who've died as well.
Yeah.
And all for what?
Okay, well, George H.W. Bush did not invade Baghdad. Is he a genius?
Well, not
What
really.
Did he know that his son did?
What he realized that his son didn't. I mean, look at what happened in 1991 after not going to Baghdad. You know, the Shiites were, you know, took up arms and we said, you know, we're sort of with you, much like we did in Hungary in 1956. And we sort of weren't. So helicopter gunships mowed them down. And it was incredibly costly for us to, you know, maintain those no-fly zones for all that time in between. So basically what that tells us is that every option is a bad option in that region. You know, and what the most incredible thing to me is, and I mean, apportioning blame is, you know, necessary. But when we looking at what the American people think about this now, you see those images of, you know, 1,700 people being killed by ISIS. I mean, these are photos that look to me like the Babi Yar massacre in 1940 of people in pits just being shot in the back of the head. And people say, well, you know, it's really not our problem. And they're not wrong about that either. It, you know, the red line is crossed in Syria of chemical weapons.
Yeah.
You say, well, you know, it's
so
not
is the
our
president
problem.
So out
this
of his
what,
depth?
This is actually what's happened. This is the result of Iraq, is that we don't even blanch at this stuff anymore.
Okay, but is the president so out of his depth that he can't get out of this mess?
Yes, absolutely. And I think that a lot of this stuff does, I mean, it comes from the Iraq War, it comes from this misguided invasion, and then it comes from the policy in Syria, where, I mean, this group has been allowed to sort of metastasize. The Free Syrian Army was originally going to be our friends, and then they were overtaken
Let's
by foreign fighters.
Guns.
These guys are imperialists. They're not Iraqis. They're not Syrians. There's 450 Brits that have gone to fight there. This is a sort of movement that is attracting the nutbags and ratbags all across the world. Now they have a little strip of territory.
I know,
a rather large strip uncharted territory.
I guess we haven't been looking at it from the right perspective the entire time. We've got World Cup fever because we beat Ghana, and that's awesome. But wars are not as clean as soccer tournaments. And, you know, how we differentiate nations, you know, it's a tribal society and way of fighting that we can't quite comprehend.
Well, some civilizations are worse than us. It was better when it was just England, and we would go, hot, 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 and then the guys at the front would die, and then the guys would move forward because it was the same kind of people. But when you're going into the Middle East, they don't have the same values as us. They don't see death. When you shoot them, they don't go, no, we shot a guy. They go, yay, I'm a martyr. I win. So we can't win because we'd have to physically alter their brains. They don't like democracy. So what I suggest, and I think it's the only solution, go in there with huge bombs, lots of media coverage, kill a bunch of them, right?
I think that's pretty much what we
no,
just
I'm talking
did.
About a three-day blitzkrieg, and then just declare victory.
I think we did all of that. You missed the whole mission accomplished banner?
It's got to be clearer. That's victory day.
You're right.
144 points.
You're the president, you come out there, you go, thanks, everyone. That was a great job. Whew, that was a close one. But we did it. God bless America. Then the doors close, and you just go, oh.
It's appropriate to point out the disgusting barbarism that takes place in a conflict like this. But again, I don't know that most Americans have really reconciled themselves to the fact that this particular failed policy has cost hundreds of thousands
of lives. Okay, I will tell you what I like
right now. And destroyed
property. I will tell you what I like. I like that you're nice and fiery. I feel like I've gotten you primed. I feel like I've taken you out and thrown some yak down your throat and gotten you right where I want you. Mm. So we're going to save that energy for John Bolton. He's coming up in just a few minutes, and I want you to take that passion and channel it toward the mustache.
Okay.
And we, by the way, are going to switch gears just a little bit. We're going to talk about Iraq, like I said, in moments. And we would love to know what that sassy partisan courtesan Lois Lerner has been up to all these years and how deeply partisan have her emails become. Well, sure, we'd love to know, but we can't because years of her electronic correspondence have conveniently and magically disappeared. She was the hack at the IRS in charge of giving groups tax-exempt status like those Tea Partiers who were singled out for their political leanings. Can't the NSA just go in and find her turfed missives? How hard is that?
I want to defer to the people who are younger than me and who know how to turn on their phones without asking their wives to come over here. You can't.
We don't have multiple wives.
I do. I'm in ISIS.
Physically lose emails. The emails exist on the servers. Am I wrong there?
That's partially right. She says, I mean, you can download them off the server and sort of erase them, but they were on a hard drive, and she said, you know, the hard drive crashed. So apparently government protocol means that you wrench it open and throw it in the garbage.
Yeah.
Because just to point out, if your hard drive crashes, it costs a lot of money, but the government is very, very good at spending money. Unless you take those plates out and smash them into bits, it's not lost. Yeah. It's like kind of, and by the way, Lois Lerner's like, yeah, I haven't told you about this for a year, by the way, but you know, that hard drive crashed? Where is it? I don't know. I just threw it in the garbage.
There are plenty of...
It seems a little bit suspicious.
There are very convenient elements of this story. Yeah. I want to go on the record, though. I'm giving the IRS the benefit of the doubt.
What?
In the event that I am eventually audited...
Because you think that government agencies
also
are so
lost
corrupt and so
it.
Incompetent,
well,
and
Peter
the combination
Suderman,
is deadly.
Peter Suderman had a point, which is that IT contracts in the federal government are so notoriously horrible. We've spent close to $1 billion on IT and Obamacare rollout. None of it has worked. And so it's possible, even though it doesn't work anywhere else in the world, that those emails would actually be erased. Maybe in government IT and their servers, it would, because they wouldn't know how to run.
It's possible that it was on a wood hard drive.
And there were little swirls? Yeah.
Yes.
With chisels and hammers?
The actual tape that it was on got burned. when they were putting on the reel to reel to save it into the SCSI cables.
SCSI. Wow, SCSI. You know, this was they're finding H.R. Haldeman's emails at this point. I mean, this is totally absurd. And like tripod addresses or Hotmail. Like the idea
you can't
that
put the toothpaste back in the tube.
The idea that they don't have a backup, by the way.
Yeah.
Like a redundant like that. Everybody has
okay,
that.
Okay, but by the way, the government has been spying on everyone for about 15 years.
Like a little longer than that. But
somehow, miraculously, they can't find Lois Lerner's emails?
Yeah,
I don't want
them. And the NSA, is that good?
I don't want them spending hundreds of hours and $10 million trying to investigate themselves. I know they're corrupt. I know they targeted the Tea Party. We got that. Done. Stop spending our money telling us how horrible you are. Just sit in a room. Just sit quietly in a room.
You know what? But there has not been a wonderfully villainous name like Lois Lerner since Lex Luthor.
Yes.
Well, and I'm not wrong about that.
Sounds a little bit like Lois Lane.
Lois Lane.
Her whole career, though, has been as a political hack, like in investigating people in possibly punitive ways. The IRS is not the first rodeo for Lois Lerner here, and that's like it's a symbol of where our so-called kind of meritocracy.
Oh, there she is.
She's growing bigger.
She's wearing purple.
She's larger.
She's wearing a helmet.
That's frightening.
Stop the investigation.
That's half for Darth Vader costume.
Stop it. We got it. You're corrupt. You're all liars.
And she is helmet. Luke's real father.
Oh, wow.
It's getting horribly uncomfortable. Gentlemen, I hope you come back and talk about some more inane topics.
I hope so, too. It's a madhouse in those hallways. ISIS just broke through the front door.
Yeah.
ISIS is our line producer.
We're going to hide in the closet.
That's actually
John
true.
John ISIS.
No.
You know, that's his name.
No, her first name is Isis.
Oh, really?
She was the nice lady who said hi to you when you were getting coffee.
Oh, my God, that's really embarrassing because it's on television now. Sorry.
It is. And it's live.
She's really sweet.
Oh, she's lovely. Absolutely. And so are the both of you. So we will have you back to discuss really smart and wonderful things in just a while. And we will continue to discuss Iraq with a passionate man who had a hand in getting us there with the younger Bush. Does he have regrets? No. Have you met John Bolton? It's The Independent. Stay with us.